leader is best when people rarely knows he exists. When his work is done, his aim fulfilled, they will say, we did it ourselves. This is a quote from Lao Tzu, a Chinese philosopher, the founder of Taoism. The leaders excel with their team and make the team feel and believe that they have done everything by themselves. Today, as part of leadership series by Global TV, we're happy to bring one such leader who makes his team believe that they have done everything by themselves. Mr. C. Padmakumar, welcome to our discussions on leadership.
Thank you, Tom.
Mr. Padmakumar is a past chairman and managing director of Terumo Penpol Private Limited, one of the largest manufacturers of blood bags probably in the world. He joined way back in 1985 in Terumo Penpol, which was then called the Penpol Limited. Later, he became the executive director and the chairman and managing director. Currently, Mr. Padmakumar is the director of Kerala Life Sciences Park Private Limited. He's a director with Trinity Skill Works Private Limited. He's a director of Maricar Motors. He's also pro bono advisor to People for Animals, Kantari, and Helping Hands, which are NGOs. Mr. Padmakumar, thank you for joining these discussions. I'm sure your words of wisdom on leadership will definitely enlighten our listeners today.
Thank you for inviting me.
You know, some people develop leadership skills at a very early age. Some develop as they come up in their career. What has been your experience? Did you have leadership skills? Did you show any incidence of leadership skills at an early age, or you built it up as you came up in your career?
You know, there is a saying, Tom, about greatness. And I think we can probably apply that here. I believe that, you know, some people are born great. And some people have greatness thrust upon them. So I think I definitely was not a born leader. I have happened to occupy a few leadership positions in my career. And if I look back to my early years, especially school, I don't think I showed much leadership qualities except for two instances. One was in my first school in Ooty, Lawrence School of Mill. I was made a prefect in the sixth standard. So that you could say is probably one early, you know, a sign that somebody felt I could occupy a leadership position. The other thing which I recollect is nobody ever gave me any formal position, but from the age of maybe 10 or so, that is from the fifth standard, I have been directing plays.
Okay.
I made the play myself, so there is a certain amount of leadership. That is the only leadership that I, you know, qualities that I have displayed in my early career. And so I'm sorry to say that, you know, I wish I could have given you a much better account of myself as a young man, but I don't think I displayed much leadership qualities early in life.
I think it's a very interesting and it's a very good lesson for aspiring leaders. See, some people think if you do not show leadership qualities when you are in the school and college, you cannot take up leadership positions. I think your lesson from your life is going to inspire a lot of youngsters, because they can now look forward to taking up leadership positions, even though they may not have had much to do when they were in the school or the college. That's very interesting. You know, sometimes our attitudes and qualities are influenced by people. Do you have anyone in your life who would have influenced your leadership style?
I think two people have been a big influence on, actually not two, three people have been a big influence on my life. The first is my father, my late father. And I had actually two brothers, one of whom passed away and one of whom is still there. My eldest brother is still with us. And all of them in different ways had a big influence on me. But I would say that the main influence on my life has definitely been my father, and in many ways I tried to model myself and my actions on whatever I saw in him, whatever I heard about him. So there are a couple of things actually which I can narrate about my father. Growing up, when I was in school, I didn't know much about what he did, except that he was a good father and that I was very comfortable with him. I felt very safe. And he was very tolerant and relaxed. Never asked me to do too many things. But I didn't know really what he did in his work or anything till I came to, actually not even in college, when I started working. And he never spoke about himself. He never said anything about what he did. So I had absolutely no idea till I started working what it was that my father actually did. I knew he was a manager on a plantation, a company, you know, earlier on it was run by the British called Harrison's Malayalam and later taken over by Indian management. So he had to run these big estates and we lived on these estates. So life was good. So when I started working, I remember I started trying to get some information about what was his experience because I wanted to try and learn something. It was very difficult to get him to say anything. So my source of information was mostly my mother. I would go to her and she would tell me certain things.
Okay.
And then I realized that actually he was very interesting person. I mean, he had an extremely colorful and interesting career.
Okay.
So if I can narrate one or two instances from his life,
please.
You know, that had a very big impact on me. So after he had been working for about 10 years, this is I'm talking about 1957, when the first communist ministry came up in Kerala, EMS Nambuthiripad's ministry.
Yeah.
Of course, this was before we were born, but life was very different then. And these communists had no idea what they were doing. So they came and actually took over the state.
Whoa.
Meaning, in every police station, there was a Communist Party cell member who used to tell the circle inspector what to do. And in this circumstances, my father was a manager in an estate in Wayanad called Sentinel Rock. This was actually a hotbed of the communist union, and my father found it very difficult because it was actually quite dangerous and risky. So I, like I said, till I started working, I had no idea that all these things had happened. And he managed to turn around an estate which they had actually planned to close down because the previous manager, who was English, said it was too dangerous. While he was there for 4 years, I was, you know, not yet born. He built a factory there. He got that estate running. And then as a reward, they transferred him to what was considered the most difficult estate in the entire group. They had about 30 factories.
Wow.
In a place near Trichur called Kundai Estate. Now, Kundai Estate was the second worst estate in Malayalam plantation.
Okay.
Out of the 32. So rank is number 31. He was on Kundai for 10 years, around the time when I was born, 61 to 71. When he left, it had become the number 2 position.
Wow.
So I was astonished. And he never said all this. Like I said, I got this from different sources.
Okay.
So I used to sit and try and ask him, see, what did you do? And the answer was very, very interesting for me. He said, I didn't do anything. So I said, no, you must have done. This will not happen by magic. Something you would have done.
Right.
He said, no, I just did my job. But then when I asked him more and more and started probing, I got some very interesting answers. See, the previous manager was a young Englishman.
Okay.
Who could not handle the workers. And it became very difficult. There were industrial relations problems, strike. And he actually wrote to the management saying, please sell this estate. You cannot manage this estate. And that's where they sent my father. First day, he went to the what is called muster, that is taking attendance. And in a rubber estate, you take attendance at 6 a.m. before the tapping starts. So as the manager of the estate, he went there and he found a very interesting sight. Where the muster roll is taken, nobody is there. So he waited till 6:15, and then slowly the assistant manager came on his bike. That guy got a shock. Then slowly the, you know, the conductor, the rubber maker, all these guys slowly started coming in. The workers came by about 6:45 or 7 a.m. I asked him, what did you do? Did you, you know, send memos and this? He said, no, I didn't do anything. Next day morning, he was there again at 6. This time, the assistant manager was already there before 6. But nobody else. He said, this continued for 3-4 days. But slowly, he said, maybe after about a week or so, people started coming on time.
Very nice.
The workers also started coming on time. Just because he was, and he never said anything. He didn't fire them. He didn't issue show cause note, nothing. He was there, that's all. Because the people started coming to the work on time, they started doing the work. And he used to go, and unlike the previous manager, he would go and actually supervise the work in the field.
Okay.
So people knew that somebody is observing, supervising, and he will, you know, help them out wherever. Anyway, that's all that he did. Now, in a sense, when you think about it, that's all that you need to do in a leadership position. You know, do your job sincerely, diligently. And people, it is because the people at the top don't do their jobs, I think that people at the bottom also become like that. There is a famous saying, the fish rot from the head.
Yes.
And I believe that. Now, the previous manager, before my father, used to spend most of his time sitting in the bungalow because he had decided that you can't work. So I found this, you know, very, and I tried to apply this in my career, you know, when I've had to deal with workers and staff and, you know, I found this experience extremely helpful for me.
I think what you said is like what we say in management, walk the talk.
Exactly.
So probably your father practiced it subconsciously, but he was just doing it.
So he was today, just, he didn't know how to say it.
Jargons about it. But those days, he just did it and it gave results. I think it's a very beautiful lesson for all of us. So have you faced any major challenges in your leadership journey? And if yes, how did you face it?
Actually, the first 20 years of my career was, you could say, one continuous series of challenges.
Okay.
But luckily, I was in a very low position for most of this time. It was only towards the later part that I came to any kind of leadership position. So I just went through it. I didn't know too much about it. But later I, you know, so our company had a lot of struggle for 20 years. Okay. And it is only after 20 years that we started seeing some kind of stability and then we started prospering. So we have had many challenges and many crises. But if I have to pick one serious challenge which, you know, affected me and I was in a leadership position, I would say this was in 1998. So the company had been in existence for about 13 years. We had established ourselves in the Indian market. We had some export business. And we were, actually, we had become a Sikh company.
Okay.
Under the IFR Act. And we came out of it. We were doing reasonably well when many Indian companies entered the market, competitors.
Okay.
And thanks to severe price competition, we were again in deep trouble. So in 1998, around, I think, April or so, an unfortunate event took place. My brother, elder brother, who was the managing director of the company, he was injured in an accident.
Okay.
And he had to be, hospitalized, and then he was confined to home for 2 months.
Okay.
Now, at the same time, we had our worst crisis, because just then our entire export business stopped.
Okay.
Our export manager left the company, and we had left it to him. In fact, I did not even have a passport. I had never been abroad till then. And my brother, so the managing director, the leader of the team, he is not available. And we were not able to pay the workers or the executive salaries for 4 months. But work was continuing. Work was still continuing. And we have, we had at that time four unions, very strong, powerful unions with political backing, plus one independent union.
Yep.
So altogether, this was a very difficult thing. So there's no cash, you can't pay salaries, there is no business, the boss is out of action. What do you do? And I had no idea what to do. I mean, from my MBA or, whatever books I had read or whom I had no idea.
No what solutions.
No solution. But I would like to share an interesting story from that time. What I feel helped me get through that period.
Okay.
One day, I called my MBA batchmate, Joseph Lewis.
Okay.
So it was at that time he was working with a company called Capital Mercury, which is a garment exporter.
Yep.
Joe was doing very well. He was flying high and doing very good business. So Joe and I are quite close. So I called him basically because I was doing so badly and feeling so demoralized. I think you know the saying, misery loves the company of misery. So I wanted to hear some misery from him.
Yep.
I asked Joe, so Joe, how are you doing? After telling him my story and all, he said, CP, I am doing so well. And I thought, why did I call this fellow? I wanted some reassurance. Other people are also doing badly. Now he's telling me, and he told me he's doing X, this, that, and so on. So I heard him out. I was thinking it was a big mistake. I should not have called him. Then after this little bit of talk, he came back to what I started with, saying that I'm feeling a little, pressurized and I don't know what to do. He said, you know what? To get your head straight, why don't you do one thing? Why don't you go and start playing something? You're a physical guy. You're not doing anything. Why don't you just go and pick up a game like golf?
Okay.
I thought this guy's completely lost it. I'm telling him that, I'm facing serious business problems. I can't pay the salary. I've got union problems. So many problems. And he's telling me, go and play a game.
Wow.
So I thought this is a waste of time. We put the phone down. Next day morning, but I had slept over it. And I thought, okay, let me see. I went. And unfortunately, the golf coach could not accommodate me. But in the same club, there was a tennis court. Okay. And I had learned tennis when I was in college. So I went and picked up the game again. And you won't believe it. Every day during that crisis period, I used to go 1.5 hours and play tennis. And that saved me.
Okay.
Because I had to concentrate on something else for that 1.5 hours, I was able to manage the rest of the day much better. And also the sheer physical activity, because I was not doing anything physical.
Right.
And then to come to, what did I do to solve the problem? Again, I didn't have much of an idea, but we made a small plan, few things that we thought we should do. And I think I tried to follow my father's model. You go and do your work sincerely each day. You try, don't think too far ahead. What you have to do today, you do it. Make a plan for say 1 week and try and do that. And slowly, after a few weeks, few months, things started slowly improving and we came out of that crisis.
Great.
I remember that as the, biggest challenge that I've had.
Very interesting, because two lessons which I think I got. One is, when you are under pressure, you don't know what to do. Pick up something else which you give you a relief from the problems what you are facing. Second thing is, go back to the basics. Do your best. Do the best possible, things will turn around as things go forward. Our sincerity and commitment will automatically turn things in our favor, provided we do our job the best way possible, because then the team will also come around and try to do their best or better. Very nice to listen to this. I just wanted to ask you about this trade unions. You said you had 4 trade unions in the company, and how was their approach, or I mean, how did you feel about the unions? Because I'm sure this is one of the challenges any corporate guy in Kerala will face today, or they're probably is afraid of or scared of, let's say, put it that way.
When we started the company, obviously there was no union.
Okay.
Factory manager came with this information saying that somebody is trying to form a union. The MD did something very different. The labor commissioner inaugurated it. The labor department took a class for these fellows. How nice. To form a union, what is a trade union, etc. And they formed a union. I'll narrate a couple of instances. Loading and unloading was going on in the factory. And initially, it was, we didn't have head load workers. We ourselves used to do it. I mean, our workers used to do it. So the truck was being loaded with cartons of blood pipes. So I was sitting in the personal manager's office for some discussion. I just happened to look around and I found one guy is throwing a carton into the truck. And it was the union leader.
Okay.
I looked at the personal manager just to see what is he going to do. Did he see? He has seen it, but he didn't do anything. So I also kept quiet. I didn't do anything. Next day, I went to the store. And I called the 4 fellows, including this chap. 4 of them were there. And I said, I just want to know whether you people are aware of, you know, what we are doing here, what kind of product and all that. So can you just tell me what you know? So they knew everything. They said, sir, it's a blood bag, critical medical device, life-saving, I said, I'll show you something, and then you tell me. And I took a carton and placed it very carefully on the table nearby.
Okay.
I took the carton and I threw it second time.
Okay.
They all looked horrified. They said, sir, how can you do this? So I said, so you know the difference, you know which is correct, which is wrong. I saw one person in the store do this yesterday. That's all I said. I didn't say anything more. We never had a problem after that. Very correctly, they used to put this thing.
Very nice.
I think, you know, instead of this typical big fight, if you use a little common sense, if you treat people with some respect, but also make sure that, you know, don't back off. Where you have to stand firm, you have to be firm.
Right.
Where there is a principle. And I have found that the unions are sometimes, they are not so easy to deal with. I've dealt with them so much. I've spent so many hours. So I know they can be unreasonable, all of that. But by and large, if you deal fairly with them, if you treat them okay and give them basic respect, they will do much more for the company. And we had an example of that. I told you about that challenge we had, you know, when we couldn't pay the salary.
Yes.
During that time, we negotiated a revision. By that time, we had long-term settlements. We negotiated a settlement whereby they were not being paid. 4 months, no wages.
Right.
They agreed to increase the production.
Wow.
So,
very nice.
I mean, so this also is the same trade union. And in 35 years, when I was with the company, we had 3 days loss of this thing due to strike.
Fantastic. 2 things which came out to me. One is, you deal with them fairly, they will also cooperate and do their best to support the company. And I think your story of how they stood by you when you had so much of difficulty, I mean, it's a very great lesson for anyone who is listening to this talk. Very nice. You are doing a lot of philanthropic activities, is it part of your leadership, or it's just that you have taken it as a cause, a societal cause, you should contribute? And what is your thought about it when it comes to leadership positions? Because there are a lot of leaders who just don't care. There are a lot of leaders who really care for the society. What is your thought about it?
As you know, I did my MBA.
Yes.
I didn't learn much, unfortunately, during my MBA because I wasn't paying enough attention. But after I finished my MBA, I have really studied business and management. Probably more than, you know, many people. And I don't agree with some of the things which are being taught. And, you know, you're sort of expected to do certain things.
Yes.
First and foremost, see, this whole emphasis on leadership itself is something I don't agree with. See, a leader is, I'm not saying it's not important. A leader is important. But it's not that important. You know, for an organization to succeed, the key people are actually the guys doing the work. If you take care of those people and make, that's the job of the leader, make sure that they have everything they need to do their work well. Right. I was fortunate because few times I had to do the same work that the worker did, not supervise them, actually. And that is why I have a lot of sympathy for workers. Because I did it and now I know why they react in certain ways.
Right.
As far as this leadership thing is concerned, I feel when you talk about, say, philanthropy, you shouldn't do it because it is expected of you as a leader. I didn't do it for that reason at all. When I was very young, I started working. My salary, first salary was 450 rupees. And out of that, I used to, for 1 year, it was very stupid of me, but 100 rupees a month, I used to give for some charity.
Right.
So what happened as a result was I had no savings. And finally, I had to go and borrow money. So that's why I said that was stupid. But I felt that, you know, you have to do something. That's been with me. And my brother also had the same thing that he felt, you know, as an individual, you owe something back to society because you've got so much from society. That has nothing to do with business or leadership. It's just a personal preference. And I think you should do it if you believe you want to do it. Don't do it. You know, this, the worst thing that I've heard of is the CSR Act, which we have in India, which is actually a tax. And they're calling it CSR. You know, it is not CSR. CSR means it's a voluntary thing.
Yes.
Now what the government is supposed to be doing, they're making us do it and calling it CSR.
I think your message is very clear that it is your personal philosophy. It has nothing to do with where you work, what you do, which leadership position you occupy. It's all about your personal philosophy of whether you want to help somebody or not. It can be that you earn so much or you don't earn so much. It's up to us. Now, as a leader, do you enjoy your leadership positions or you find it burdensome? Because I know some leaders who occupy high position, they think it's a big burden on their shoulders.
No, I didn't look on it as a burden. But frankly, I don't really enjoy this leadership role. Sometimes I have been put in that role. I have tried to do it to the best of my ability. But I think as, you know, in terms of my nature and personality, I don't think I was cut out to be a leader. I prefer to be a team member. I prefer to work. See, for example, most of the time in a sporting team, when I was in school and college, I was a member of the team. I was quite good at some sports. I could contribute, but very rarely was I the captain. In fact, I think only once I was made captain, and that was when I was doing my MBA. Nobody ever made me a captain of the team. So I've always felt that my best efforts have come when I was doing something, rather than just this, you know, leading and directing is not something for me.
So the message is you can be a successful leader just by doing it. Don't assume that you are a leader and just continue to do what you are good at doing and people will respect you. And I think it goes back to the introduction what I told about a leader being invisible to the team and just doing your job. And the team should think that they have done everything by themselves. I think you fall perfectly into that. I mean, whatever philosophy of leadership.
But I tell you something about that, Tom. They see, there's a very interesting point.
Yeah.
From what you quoted, it appears yes. that, you know, the leader creates the conditions such that the team feels they are doing it.
Yes.
Although actually the leader has done quite a bit.
Yes.
Isn't it?
Yes.
I'll give you a slightly different take on that same point from okay. a personal experience of mine. See, right. I was working with Penpol, Peninsula Polymers Limited, in 1992. I was working yeah. as the factory manager. And at that time, our products were being marketed in India by a big pharma company called TTK Pharma, part right. of the TTK group.
Right.
One fine morning, I was informed by my boss that from next month, I am going to be leaving Penpol. I will be in TTK Pharma and heading their sales division for okay. These medical divisions. I didn't okay. want to go, and nobody asked my opinion or anything. But I suddenly found I have to go. I had no other choice. So I went, and I knew nothing about sales. I had never done any selling or, you know, sales management. No orientation, no induction, nothing. And my boss was, he was a very competent person, very smart guy. But he was not interested in these products. So he said, Padma Kumar, you just go and you know all these guys, he said. I knew the, you know, members of the team. Now, all these fellows were older than the, my managers. I'm the sales manager. So we had regional managers in Bombay, Delhi, Calcutta, Hyderabad, Chennai, everywhere. So they're all seasoned salesmen. So I was thinking, how do I manage this? I know nothing. They know everything. So I did one thing. Whenever I'm in doubt, I will go to the spot. The Japanese okay. call this gemba, going and
yes,
to the spot.
Yes, yes,
so
yes,
in
yes.
sales, you have to go meet customers. So I went and met customers right through the country. And my boss was happy to get me out of the office. And so he doesn't have to worry about me. He'll say, go. I went.
Okay.
And we did okay. We did reasonably all right. And I found that, see, I was not really adding too much because what could I add to these guys? But they needed certain things to right. do their jobs. They needed some resources. They needed some decisions. They needed some budget. They would tell me what they needed. I would do a little cross-check because I met all the customers.
Right.
And if I gave it to them, they would give me the results. So now you tell me whether I was doing it or they were doing it. It's a difficult question.
No, I would relate to, you know, what your father did, like going and being there at 6 o'clock in the morning. And it, to me, I'll tell you, it makes a lot of sense when you go around and be in the field. They may not express it, but they feel it. You being on the spot, being with them, being with the yes. customers. Then what happens is tomorrow, when they have to narrate something back to you, they know, okay, Bose knows this customer. He knows exactly what his sentiments are. So they'll feel much more at free to talk to you. We may not contribute to their working, but you contribute their psychology. This is what I believe, because I also do a lot of going to the field, being with the customers. Even now I do that because it gives a tremendous amount of confidence to the guy in the field. So I think that way it makes sense. And they feel, end of the day, they'll feel, yes, I did it. And we also clap saying that you did it. There'll be some contribution, but they feel good about it. Thank you so much, Padma Kumar. It is a very, very interesting. I think you shared a lot of stories. I'm sure the listeners will have some time to really think through. And thank you so much for your time.
Thank
and
you.
Let's hope we'll meet again.
Sure.
Thank you.